Hello, this is Jared Brock, aka Agent Scone, coming at you with a draft analysis video, specifically a top 8 of a super limited qualifier for Lord of the Rings that I did earlier today, went 8-0 into 8-2 in the Swiss rounds, ended up in 7th place. And fortunately, I didn't take a pick of my sealed deck, but it was essentially just a streamlined black-red deck with Horn of Gondor, and Horn of Gondor, of course, does a ton of work. So decided to record the draft, was not able to do any live commentary, but figured it'd be fun to go back and analyze the draft and the rounds and share that knowledge with you guys. And I'll try to go through all of my picks and kind of my general approach to drafting in general, and especially at this high level. So without further ado, we can just go ahead and play it. All right, so starting off the draft, pack one, pick one. Once I, you know, adjust the card size and all of that. So pack one, pick one, we have a few choices. The rare's pretty bad. Press the Emmy, I have not liked very much. But so the uncommons are all pretty good. We have Gandalf Sanction, Gandalf, and March from the Black Gate. And I go ahead and highlight Gandalf Sanction because, well, one, I think it's better than Gandalf and March, and I think it's enough better that even though that March and Gandalf are monocolored, Gandalf Sanction just has such high upside. And in terms of commons that we're passing up, we're really not giving up much. Lorien Revealed is the best card in the pack and probably my next pick, honestly. So I'm a huge fan of blue-red in this format. Carl Chase or 2DuckCubed, he's been the pioneering expert on soft forcing blue-red, and I've really enjoyed it in this format. And honestly, I'm just super happy to start with Gandalf Sanction in this draft. So, you know, if there was like a Nazgul or a Fel Beast or even a Claim the Precious, I would probably take that over Gandalf Sanction. I'm definitely not above trying to be that one black player or having like five black cards in a decent black red or black blue deck. But yeah, anyway, snapping up Gandalf Sanction, pack one, pick one. And pack one, pick two, again, another pretty easy choice in Grishnok, although I am sad to pass up on Rohirrim Lancer and especially Smite the Deathless. But even though Grishnok doesn't really synergize all that great with Gandalf Sanction specifically, or those types of blue-red spells, payoffs and whatnot, it's just a really strong card, really good rate, and that's something that you don't really want to, you know, pass up on. At its worst, it's like a kind of bad Dunland Creebane, or like a slightly worse version, rather. But at its best, it's putting two things on the board and dealing like two to your opponent, and the ceiling can just go like much, much higher than that, though that doesn't come up that much. But anyway, really happy with this start. Gandalf Sanction into Grishnok. Love blue red. Totally willing to hop off of, you know, either color. I've also really enjoyed blue black in this format, but yeah, honestly, just really happy to take Grishnok here. Not giving up on much. I mean, there's an Arwen's Gift. Again, the main thing is Smite the Deathless. You can even see here I'm a little sad to pass it, but yeah, not really a close pick at all. Here, super easy, Birthday Escape. Birthday Escape is one of the best cards in the deck and the best blue common. Other cards for the deck are Rivendell is fine upside. You end up tempting usually a lot. And there's a Quarrel's End. And again, not much else. A couple of medium to bad black cards and Haunt of the Dead Marshes and Mirkwood Bats. If you're in green, Bag and Porter's fine. Entrap Basin's basically a blank. So yeah, honestly, I mean, not really any consideration here. Pretty easy Birthday Escape. So here, definitely a little bit of a brick in terms of the blue-red deck, but really it's kind of just a brick in general. So the best card is probably Enraged Hjorn. But I basically never want to be green in this format. Like, I want to be some combination of Grixis, maybe white if it's paired with black, rarely white if it's paired with red, and almost never green unless it's like wildly open and you get two Frodos and a bunch of lands and that sort of thing and a bunch of fixing. But here I take Gorbog, which I, you know, aka garbage, but even though Gorbog's not good, I do believe it is the it's the only black card in the pack. And I don't want to be green, so I don't even want to. I just want to keep other people in green if that's what they're doing. And Knights of Del-Amroth and Surrounded by Orcs are really just, and Gimli's Axe are really just not what you want to be doing for the blue-red deck. So I just pick up Gorbach here as a speculation. So here the choice is between Easterling Vanguard, Hithelane Knots, and probably Bewitching Leechcraft. Bewitching Leechcraft is not the kind of removal you want, but sometimes, you know, you get desperate and you gotta play some removal spells. But I end up going with the Hithelane Knots because, again, I'd much rather be blue-red, especially at this point with the Gandalf Sanction, Grishnok, Birthday Escape. And Hithelane Knots, I'm pretty high on. It's a spell that's really, really important, especially for Gandalf Sanction. And it gives you not card advantage, but it gives you time. Time to deploy your threats, protects you from dying. Okay, so here's an interesting pick. We have Rohirrim Lancer, which is a great card, but I go ahead and go with the Deceive the Messenger. So at this point, I would much rather like stake my claim in blue, and because I feel like people are catching on that blue is one of the best colors. Like, if this was an arena draft or something, drafting with your average folks, then Deceive the Messenger is criminally underrated, but this is a top eight of a competitive limited event. I imagine everybody knows how good blue is and how good Deceive the Messenger is. It again, it's a spell, and also just the kind of blowouts you can get with it is just really nice. There's tons of X1s. Like, think of the Easterling Vanguard 2-1. Clean answer to it. Absolutely amazing. This is just a brick for everybody, unless you're in green, you can take like Mirkwood Spider or something like that. But I just take this moment to speculate on the Great Hall of the Citadel. Just in case maybe I open a Eowyn or something and there's nothing good to take over it, and you can speculate on that, have like a couple of these and splash that. The rare Eowyn, of course. And here I believe this is pick eight, so very, very happy to get a Dreadful as the Storm. This card has just gone way, way up in my pick order. It's super good, you know, especially with the orc tokens, because it essentially gives it +5/+5 out of nowhere. So here's the wheel. Press the Enemy versus Olgai Crusher. I don't really like Press the Enemy that much. I haven't really had reps with it. It's kind of like a bad Venser, but I mean, Olgai Crusher is essentially unplayable as just a 4-mana 4/4 trample. Like, it's okay. I feel like there's a slight chance I'll play Press the Enemy. And picking up a Treason of Isengard here is not the worst. I also look at the Fire of Orthanc, which is a fine sideboard card against the many degenerate colorless artifacts like Palantir and I can't remember names right now, and Horn of Gondor, Arendelle, the best one in the set. Nothing really here on the wheel. I just take Gimli's Axe to send the signal, stay out of red, but you know, not really anything there. Take the Surrounded by Orcs. There's a slight chance I'll play it, but again, highly, highly doubt it. Kind of happy here to take away a Black Breath from the pile, because usually these blue-red decks have a lot of X1s and 1/1s and whatnot, so kind of nice to make sure that there's one less of those in someone's sideboard against you. All right, and pack two, pick one, opening one of the best cards in the set for blue-red specifically, Bilbo, Retired Burglar. Unfortunately, passing up on Peligre Survivor and more importantly, Rally at the Hornburg. And spoiler alert, I definitely wish I had a rally, but Bilbo is just fantastic. It comes down, and if it's unchecked, it will take over the game. Hard to block, and when you do connect with the opponent, you get to make treasure, which allows you to cast more spells. It's just absolutely fantastic. So great pickup. And Windmill Slam Éomer, this is the best uncommon in the set. I would take it over almost every single rare and mythic in the in the set, no matter what. Pack one, pick one, and just in general. It was absolutely fantastic. One of the best cards I could have honestly hoped for. So at this point, I'm feeling very, very good about my start for this pack specifically. Pack one was okay, but this beginning of pack two is honestly just fantastic. And on the wheel, Coral's End is really the only card I would want in this sort of deck. I'm getting a little bit choked up on the three drops though, so yeah, a little bit worried I'm not getting enough cheap stuff, but I mean, just super happy to have Aelmer. Very, very good. Okay, and yeah, easy Smite the Deathless here. So there's Maneldor, Arwen's Gift, and Coral's End as well, but not even close. You want cheap interaction, you want cheap spells. Smite the Deathless is easily the second best red common in the set, second to Rally at the Hornburg. And yes, pack one, pick one, I would take Rally over Smite. You can fight me on that, but yeah, Smite the Deathless is absolutely fantastic. And here it's kind of a blank. We have a Hithling Knots versus a War Beast. I like War Beast. I will play one in blue red. But again, just trying to keep that concentration of spells high. Noting here, a very late Dunland Creebane, but I think at this point we're pretty much just locked into blue red. And here, the only pick really is another Hithling Knots. It could take a Kingfisher, but I'm already choked up on threes. Having three knots is not ideal, but I mean, it's another cheap spell, and again, it helps me get to my better cards, helps me stay alive against Aelmer, against other decks, and helps me get to Aelmer so I can start smashing face. So at this point, this is a fairly decent start for blue-red deck. I think it could definitely use... There's definitely some pieces missing, but I think overall I'm pretty happy. We got two of the best uncommons. So here there's a choice. The three uncommons here are all fairly decent. And you can see I actually highlight Bill because, again, I am a little bit worried about my curve. And I actually think about this pick for quite a while. And I basically go between Bill and Maneldor. Maneldor's not great usually, just in general, and you know, especially at blue red, because there aren't a whole lot of ETBs, but it is good with Grishnok, it is good with Bilbo. Not really good with anything else per se. Bill is fine as an early attacker and blocker, but a 2-1 body is really not that great. I did know that there was another Maneldor in a previous pack, but I can't remember exactly. I don't think there was too much over it, so I end up going with the Maneldor. Not too sure about this one, because the problem with this set in general is that there's so many good 4-drops, like, you know, Torment of Gollum and Gandalf and Maneldor and just so many good 4-drops. But I just feel like Maneldor is going to be a bit better for this deck. I could definitely see that going the other way. Here it's between Spearmaster and Hithling Knots number 4. I do end up going with the Hithling Knots. Again, I'm getting pretty high on the threes, and I don't even know if I'll play a Spearmaster. This could be I could see making this pick a bit differently, actually. I do end up going with the fourth Hithling Knots. And again, just trying to get to my good cards at 3, 4, and 5 mana. Okay, here it's a very, very easy Quarrel's End. I believe this is the wheel, if I'm not mistaken. Or perhaps not, but anyway, Quarrel's End, super, super decent card to get. It makes a body, it draws you cards, it's a spell, again. Nothing really here, but I do take that Fire of Orthanc for the sideboard. Again, just to have it against busted artifacts if they so happen to show up. I keep looking at this Press the Enemy. I'm very kind of sad about it, but I'm thinking here that, you know, you Press the Enemy and Hithling not something perhaps in the same turn could be a decent tempo swing, but obviously I'm looking to pick up some better cards. So the first part of this pack was just absolutely fantastic. We got Bilbo, Éomer, Smite the Deathless, just really, really good stuff. And then it kind of fell off a little bit. In the two drops, we still have those Hithling Knots, which is fine, but not absolutely amazing. Here, I just take another Quarrel's End. Happy to have those. And you can see now I'm already going ahead and putting the Treason of Isengard over to the side because, well, once again, getting a lot of those threes, and I don't want to be too choked up on them, so I just go ahead and take it. Really, really like Quarrel's End in this deck. Great way to refuel, get more stuff, and yeah, not too unhappy with where I'm at. Again, just looking for those cheap cards. Then we get the third Quarrel's End, and I just wish with all my might that I could will it into becoming a rally, but it will sadly not become a rally no matter how hard I try. Take a bunch of nothing in the last couple of packs. Hey, those artifact players better watch out. We have two Fire of War Thanks. All right, so going into pack three, I'm fairly happy with my deck so far. Okay, so here is the pick. Pack three, pick one. Bath Song versus Rally at the Hornburg. And I think about this one for a little bit. And I, you know what? I think I disagree with myself here, all things considered, given the deck as it stands. I believe the correct pick was Rally. Bath Song is absolutely amazing in blue-red. Helps, refuel you. It helps to, get more cards, see more cards. Adds mana after the third chapter, so you can deploy all those cards. Just super fantastic. And, in a pack one, pick one scenario, I would take Bath Song over Rally, but just given where we're at here, I believe Rally was the pick. Because again, my only two drops besides the Smite the Deathless are the four Hithling Knots. They don't make bodies. So, and even though I probably don't want to play Press the Enemy, I do believe that this was a mispick on my part. Here I take a club. Arwen's Gift is just another 4-mana draw spell. I really don't need it. There's also an Olyphant, which is fine. I'd much rather have a Lorien revealed. And again, this is another reason why I'm a little regretful that I did not take the Rally at the Hornburg, but club is still such a great card in the deck. Just kind of domed them for four out of nowhere. Totally fine. Getting past Fire Inscription, absolutely ecstatic. Fire Inscription is a huge bomb in this deck. It's like an A minus. Because there's just so many spells. I mean, look, I have four creatures and 15 spells. I guess 14 and one of them is Bath Song, but yeah, it's just the game plan in and of itself. There's not a whole lot of enchantment removal, but yeah, Fire Inscription. I know we're choked up on threes, but like, yeah, now we have the trifecta of good blue-red cards. We have Gandalf Sanction, we have Bilbo, we have Fire Inscription. So here, the choices between Olyphant and a fourth Quarrel's End. I really don't want a fourth Quarrel's End, so I just pick up the Olyphant, add a little bit of consistency to the deck. And the best card in the pack is probably Maher, if I'm pronouncing that right, the black-red uncommon. I think about taking a Bewitching Leechcraft, actually, but that's debatable. Here, I think it's a really easy Deceive the Messenger number two. There's also a Goblin Fire Leaper, but I have not found Goblin Fire Leaper to be super impressive. Deceive the Messenger is a body in of itself, and again, it just all those things I was talking about earlier. It's just super great against X1s, kind of eats them for free, is a spell, and now we have the two major spells payoffs for in both Gandalf Sanction and Fire Inscription, so super happy to pick up another Deceive the Messenger. All right, and almost look here, super happy to see a Pelipper Survivor. It is a two drop. It does the thing that we need it to do. Helps cast all my spells a little bit earlier. The fact that Pelipper Survivor adds any mana of any color is just absolutely fantastic. So even if you're like flooded on blue sources, you can still cast your Quarrel's End. And that's huge. Absolutely huge. You can still cast your Smite the Deathless and whatnot. So really ecstatic to see a Pelipper Survivor this late. And right now we're looking at 23 spells, and really the Great Hall shouldn't be here anymore. Of course, I do eventually take it out. And given the amount of three drops that I have, we'll get to this when we get to the deck building portion, but we really do want 17 lands plus Olifant, at least in my opinion. We're doing a lot of card selection and whatnot, a little bit of card advantage, but we really want to hit three mana. Hithling Knots helps a little bit with that, but we just want a lot of lands. And I think this is the last pack before the wheel, and getting an Isolation at Orthanc is just absolutely fantastic. Really, really decent removal spell for the blue-red deck. It gets hurt a little bit in terms of the fact that there's so much ring looting, and so you can get that card back really fast, but so be it. Here, I mean, the pack is essentially a blank for me, but I think about, is there a slight chance that Gimli's Fury is going to be good, or is it worth it to hate draft? Like, I guess Grond is the best in the pack, but it's not even that good. I think I just end up taking Gimli's Fury. I'm not really, looking to play it at all, but it's okay. Here I take Ithilien Kingfisher. It's probably not making the deck because again, I have so many three drops, and Kingfisher is not a spell. Here, I kind of think about the same thing, surrounded by orcs versus like Haunt as like a hating of their precious black commons. But in any case, a second Dreadfulness of Storm and the fourth Quarrel's End wheeling. So I think at this point it's clear to see we're not really getting much else. So all in all, I was fairly happy with the draft portion, and I think the biggest mispick was Bathsong versus Rally. I believe I should have taken Rally. I think that would have been a lot better. And I think you'll see in the match that that turns out to be true. Okay, so now we get to the deck building portion, and as you can see, I kind of have my 23 already lined up. Overall, I think it's a fairly decent blue-red deck. It's kind of like a 9 out of 10 or 9.5 out of 10 in terms of enablers and like some powerful cards. Or sorry, not enablers. 9 out of 10 in terms of powerful cards and payoffs with Bilbo, Gandalf Sanction, Fire Inscription, Éomer, and that sort of thing. And some like the Deathless too can be in that camp. But it's like a like a 6.5 or maybe a 7 out of 10 in terms of enablers. Again, no rallies really, really hurts, and I do believe I should have taken the rally over Bathsong the more I think about it. So I contemplate this as my 23. The other consideration is to bring in the Treason of Isengard as another way to buy back Gandalf Sanction, or maybe the fourth Hithling Knots to help survive against aggressive starts. Sorry, I actually did want to talk about that just a little bit. Here I sort by color in order to see my red versus blue pips and whatnot. Clearly, there are more blue cards than red cards. So, in terms of like a 9-8 split, or the 17 land split, I debated about this for a while. It's essentially what the client gives me as a suggestion is 9 islands, 8 mountains, which on the surface seems fine, but then you have to consider the Olifant is like a ninth mountain, so then you have like a 9/9 mana base, and most of my early cheap stuff is blue. You want to play Birthday Escape on turn one. You probably wanted to see the Messenger on their two drop on turn two, or something like that. You want to be able to Hithling Knots pretty much every time, in order or play Peligro's Reviver, hopefully, in order to like get the train going and start drawing your expensive stuff. So I do actually end up settling on a 10/7, which again really is a 10/8 because of the Olifant. And so I think I contemplate it for a little bit longer here, but I think I can just go ahead and skip ahead. That is what we end up with. I think I put 9/8, and then No. We ended up going with the 10-8 mana base. So that's the deck. One thing, go ahead and save the deck list and whatnot. So one thing, I think I also made a mistake here in the deck build. So I do end up going with that Press the Enemy in the main deck. However, I do believe I should have taken it out for the fourth Hithling Knots, possibly even the Treason of Isengard. You'll see in the game, it didn't end up playing out quite as good as I hoped. I know it's not like a great card, but I figured maybe in this deck, if you press the enemy something and then also cast like a See the Messenger or Brook the Escape or kill something with the Smite the Deathless or that sort of thing, or heck, even like Gandalf Sanction instant speed, that'd be super sick. So I guess I got caught up in like maybe the high end of things, but just given the way that this deck, functions and the fact that the curve's a little bit higher than I want, even with 18 mana sources, really just wanted to have like, Treason or another Hithling Knots or something like that. So those two glaring mistakes aside, that's the draft, and we'll go ahead and get into the match. All right, and we are back with the quarterfinals. This is a very important one to win because the top four qualify for the regional championship in Atlanta. So obviously, really hoping to win this first round, and no big deal. We just have to beat one of the best players on the planet, Nathan Stoyer, in order to make it to top four. So clearly, not a big deal. Let's just go ahead and move into the match. And also, the way it works is I will always lose the die roll here because the way it works in the top eight for this environment is the player who goes first, it depends on your seed. Nathan was third place, I was seventh place, therefore he gets to be on the play. It just is what it is. And that's just the way it goes. So I go ahead and keep this opening hand here. And the reason being is that even though it's pretty island heavy, no mountains, we do have that turn two Hithling Knots. We have the turn four Bathsong, just hoping to convert Hithling Knots into, a red source for Coral and Bathsong, and hopefully just, draw into my good stuff. And that all kind of goes out the window when on turn two he slams a Frodo, which probably one of the best turn two plays in the entire format, which makes me a little bit scared. And drawing another island doesn't make me feel that much better. So here I decide to go. I figure I'm just going to Hithling Knots no matter what. It's not like tapping down whatever three drop he plays is not going to. It's not going to matter that much. I put an island on the bottom. I draw another island. We're not. It's not great. It's definitely not great. He slams an Eren Rider, draws a card. We draw a three drop, but it is not the three drop we want to see. It's Bilbo. Would have just much rather wanted to see a mountain. Very, very sad. And turn four, the hits keep coming. He just plays a Gandalf, Friend of the Shire, triggering Frodo, which triggers Gandalf. Just absolutely great. And also, I apologize for all of my nervous mouse movement. Definitely just wasn't really thinking about that, just trying to play to the best of my ability. So I have these little nervous twitches in the mouse. I hope that's not too distracting, so again, my apologies for that. So it's not looking good, but we do draw the mountain. So one option is to play Bilbo, one option is to, play the Quarrel's End to get a blocker out. But in actuality, he's not pressuring me for all that much. He's pressuring me for six total damage, which it's a decent amount, but it's not like game breaking. So I do end up deciding to go with the Bathsong, hopefully to try to double spell on a future turn and on that third chapter of the Bath Song, just kind of really go off. Well, he does play a Meridac Brandy Buck, which again, just legend stuffs over here. Third part on the ring, really close to doming me for three on attacks. Gets to make a food token, just getting so much value. Just it's gonna be really hard to come back from this point. Still, luckily, only six damage. I am at 10, so at least there's that. And on my turn, we take the draw step. We do find that second mountain, which is absolutely great. We draw a couple of cards. We just go ahead and put one of those islands back and think for a little bit here. So basically, we definitely want to smite something. And then I think about whether or not I want to play a Coral's End or a Bilbo. Get the mountain down. I decided to go with the Bilbo because it does cleanly block two of the attacks, but Reprieve. I mean, Reprieve is just a really good card. So that's really unfortunate. I decide to go ahead and I know I'm going to smite. I decided to do it here just in case he has some sort of combat trick in order to save Frodo. Frodo has the potential to keep moving up the chain to that fourth ring level, but of course it doesn't matter. He plays a quick beam and I die. So very sad game one. Didn't really have much of a chance there. Just kind of got absolutely decimated. So not great. However, moving on to sideboarding, I'm feeling a little bit more optimistic because we are on the play, which is a honestly just a huge deal in most Magic games, but also this particular match, of course. I debate going, maybe down oppress the enemy, up another Hithlane Knots, which I mean, I think that should have just been the deck. I don't think press the enemy. Whatever. We'll see in this game. I think there's a little bit of talking about when press the enemy comes up. So after a little bit of debate, I just go ahead and decide to run it back. I don't really think there's any changes. There's no artifacts, so Fire of Orthanc's not really gonna, do anything. And it's not like we're gonna get into a point. We're gonna be behind most of the game, so I figure it's not like we're gonna need to falter them or whatever that. Anyway, keep the opening hand off the basically just off of the turn one Birthday Escape and couple expensive cards. Might seem like a weird keep. I think it was okay just given the contents of my deck and the fact that, the Birthday Escape helps with the ring tempting, which we don't have a lot of, but just again cantripping to try to find those cards and mulliganing in limited is such a beating. So I decided to keep. Maybe some people wouldn't mold. It ended up working out. Spoiler alert. So anyway, we go ahead and slam Grishnok, steal Woe's Pathfinder, attack for one. Fairly modest play, but yeah, unfortunately, I don't have anything I can use the mana for except for cycling Oliphant, but it's not. Doesn't really matter. I'm not going to do that. I have plenty of lands in hand already, so Oliphant is just going to be a nice threat later in the game. He does have four mana now available to him. He goes ahead and plays a Mushroom Watchdogs and goes ahead and sacks the token right away, which he made earlier from the many partings, in order to cast, in order to make it a 3/3 rather. So here I believe I just pass. Yeah, I'm not gonna attack the 2/2 and a 3/3. Very, fairly obvious trick. Like I don't think he's gonna just blindly block the 3/3 into the 2/2 and let me deceive the messenger him or anything like that. Plays the Mushroom Watchdogs. I consider Venturing this, press the enemy back to the hand, but I figured it'd probably be better to either try it again with a deceive the messenger or just press the enemy at the end of turn, which I do decide to do. I decide to press the enemy. I was thinking about the mana dork, but in the end, I just go ahead and try to get the most power off of the board in the countered Mushroom Watchdogs. And I bounce that to hand. And press the enemy allows you to cast a spell with mana value, in this case, two or less, without paying its mana cost. So that could be the deceive. And at first, you think, oh, I'm just going to slam deceive, free spell. But I think about it for a little bit, and I figure that Deceive the Messenger is going to be better to hold on to the Deceive the Messenger for a later turn, try to get a little bit of a blowout, maybe kind of doesn't stops playing around it or something. And here, I'm just going to pause here for a second. So here's the point where I truly realize that press the enemy, I just wish it was another Hithlane Knots. Like in that situation, I would have rather just, scry this mountain away and drum another card, right? Maybe get another cheap spell to play, maybe another Hithlane Knots, draw another card, that sort of thing. So press the enemy, it was okay. It was just a four mana bounce spell. Hithlane Knots would have been better, and even though it's kind of tempoing him, he has to re-spend that mana to recast the Mushroom Watchdogs. I mean, two mana 2/2 at this point in the game, not even that big of a deal, or I guess it was a 3/3, but even so, I did not. I wish I had another Hithlane Knots, is basically what I'm trying to say. So anyway, continuing on with the game, we get another land on top. We just, fine. We're really trying to just play to Oliphant, and that's kind of what we're trying to do. I decided to go in there with the token. On the no blocks, I do decide to essentially just start the burn plan, give +5/+5 to the Orc Army token. I believe we. What do we make the Ring Bearer? We make the 2/2 to the Ring Bearer because Grishnok can just be blocked by the Wisp Pathfinder, not that effective. So essentially dealing 7 to the face. And the reason I did that after. Sorry, pausing here for a second. The reason I did that after blocks were declared, or no blocks were declared rather, is because I just wanted to do a bunch of damage. And, that's the one thing about Dreadful as a Storm that's a slight knock against it. It's a great card, but if you make your thing a 5/5 or a 7/7 or whatever in before combat and they have blockers, they're just going to chump block. There's not trample or anything. You get the ring loot. So that's what I was trading in a ring loot for essentially 7 points of damage, which I think is much more relevant. Okay, Nathan plays a Dunedain Rangers, gets a ring tempt going, and also recast the Mushroom Watchdogs that we know about. And I think that he's going to attack with the Mushroom Watchdogs, but probably, maybe correctly so, playing around to deceive the messenger. So here I consider attacking because he can only block with one of the 2/2. Consider attacking with the 2/2 Orc Army. Maybe I can deceive the messenger because one train of thought is just like play land Olifant Pass. The other thought is maybe you Orc Army token deceive the messenger and you draw another relevant spell. In which case, you would want to get that extra loot. And so I debate this for a little bit. Like, do I want to keep my 2/2? In the end, I do decide to. Again, we're pushing the advantage. He doesn't have any life gain currently at the moment. I do draw Fire Inscription, which, like I was saying earlier, is another spell to play after a deceive, after a, I think, inevitable block here. Interesting choice. I just realized that he blocks with the Ring Bearer Mushroom Watchdogs, which I think is. Oh, right, because of the Dunedain Rangers, of course. So, anyway, sorry, I just wanted to explain this a little bit more. So I know I was just talking about maybe to see the messenger in that scenario and then like, slamming my other relevant spell, but because it's Fire Inscription specifically, I did want to just go ahead and get Olifant down. I wanted to, get Fire Inscription and to see the messenger, get those precious gutter snipe shots at my opponent. So I slam Olifant and pass, just really hoping he doesn't have some sort of kill spell for the Olifant. Because he blocked with the Ring Bearer, now he can use the Ranger's landfall ability. He gets in for two with the second ring tempt, which of course gives him the loot. And I mean that's pretty good. So I just go ahead and take the damage. No need to chump block two damage, not a big deal. He plays a Mirkwood Spider, and that makes me a little bit sad. And also an Eagles. So here we obviously slam the Fiery Inscription. And I go ahead and make Grishnok the Ring Bearer. Because in this case, either he can block it. Because if I didn't do this, right, he could just block the 4/4 on the 3/1 and deceive the messenger, not very effective in that scenario. Here I get the Ring Loot and I just discard a land. Get Bilbo, which is very nice. Unfortunately, I can't go deceive and Bilbo in the same turn. That would be fantastic, but it is what it is. So I believe Nathan may still be playing around deceive the messenger here. So he definitely thinks for a while about these blocks. At first, he's going with the Mirkwood Bats on the Grishnok, and I think he had both the Eagles and the Rangers on the Oliphant. Takes it back a little bit because in that scenario I would basically just deceive the messenger and then kill off like the Dunedain Rangers probably leaving the Grishnok behind, but in the end I believe this block is what he goes with. Yes, he does. So I just go ahead and save the Olifant. I believe it is going to represent a ton of damage. So I go ahead and deceive the messenger, the rangers, thus killing it and leaving my Oliphant behind. The eagles and the Grishnok will trade. And I deal a little bit of burn damage in the 2 damage from the trample and also the 2 damage from the spell and fire inscription. Fortunately, can't play the Bilbo, so I just pass turn. And I believe at this point, gets some card draw going. So really hoping he does not have an answer for the Oliphant, because if I'm able to untap and attack with 9 trample damage, plus having Bilbo in order to, convert that into 3 extra damage, not really a way I can see him coming back from that. Unfortunately, he does find the Ents Fury, and yeah, he does find the Ents Fury, basically using it to trade the spider with the Oliphant, and there it is. Okay. So unfortunate. Oliphant was representing a ton of damage, but I'm really glad it got in the damage that it did. Cleared his board out a little bit in combination with the Deceive the Messenger. Seeing land, not great. So what I decided to do, I just go ahead and get up to the fourth ring tent. Nathan can't really afford to take 4 damage here with an active fire inscription on board. He doesn't know I have a land. So I'm just gonna go ahead and try to loot. And he almost assuredly blocks with the Woe's Pathfinder. Really unfortunate drawing another land, so I just go ahead and pitch a mountain and there's the block. So I go ahead and pass the turn back to Nathan. Really just need a couple of spells to get going here. So I believe he's playing around some more spells, so he decides not to attack with the Mushroom Watchdogs and get that trigger, which I don't think I would have blocked. Really happy to see a Quarrel's End off the top of the library, making sure to leave a little bit more blue mana up. Get 2 damage, draw more cards, hopefully draw more spells, maybe draw a ring tent thing. Again, reprieve. The same as game one. It's pretty devastating here. I essentially pay 3 mana to discard a card and deal 2 to the face, which, he's at 6 life, so it's certainly relevant, but, we just go ahead and decide to pass a turn. And now he's, of course, playing with perfect information. He knows I have nothing. Flashes in a Gandalf, which is not great. So, interestingly enough, he does decide to go for the swing out. Again, he's not playing around anything because he knows I have nothing at this point. I think he just wants the loot, discards a land. I opt not to block. I could block either one, but I'm just a little bit afraid of a, what's it called? A combat trick. But here we rip Aylmer off the top. I decide to go for it. I figured I could Quarrel's End and discard Aylmer, but I feel like if they deal with Aylmer, I still have the Quarrel's End, and I'm not getting pressured for a lot of damage. And he just can't. He doesn't have an answer in his hand. So, Aylmer and Bilbo attack for game. So, going into the round, I believe I think correctly, get rid of the Press the Enemy, and take a look at some other cards, but I'm pretty sure I put in the Hithling Knots here for game three. And I consider maybe taking out something else, but being on the play for Nathan is definitely a huge advantage. And again, Press the Enemy was just ended up being a very bad Venser Shaper's of Haunt, so I believe you just go ahead and skip it. Oh, there we go. I just go ahead and take out the press, put in the knots, submit the deck. We just gotta go for it. Okay, so obviously we're on the draw, and let's see this opening hand. I go ahead and keep it. It's a little awkward, but we do have the turn 2 Hithling Knots, improvised club. Fine for the later part of the game, not great. 4 lands is a lot. Mineldor is okay, but again, I'm just going off of that turn 2 Hithling Knots and the fact that, again, Mulligan Unlimited, not always the most ideal. He fetches up an island, makes a food token of many partings. I play a land and pass. We draw an Isolation or Thank, which I'm glad I'm just, you know, drawing some spells. Opponent plays, he plays an island and passes, which is very good for me. I draw Gandalf Sanction. Not great to see, like, at this particular moment, but just absolutely a great card to see in general for the deck. He plays an Eren Rider, no legend on board, so basically it's just going to be a loot, which, you know, 3 mana, 3/2 that loots, it's very good. Okay, I'm just going to, again, Hithling Knots, basically no matter what, put that land on the bottom. Draw another land, of course, as I do. Perfect draw, though, in the Coral's End, so slam that island, play Coral's End, discard a land, draw, you know, two more lands. That's exactly what you want to be seeing with your Coral's Ends. Attacks for three. I don't block. I figured I could take that at this point. I believe he follows this up with Bathsong, and now I get a little worried because unlike my Bathsong game one, I am not applying enough pressure to Nathan at this point for the tempo loss of Bathsong, of him playing the Bathsong and just kind of dirtling for a little bit to matter. Drawing another land off the top, obviously not ideal, but just go ahead and slam the Maneldor and attack for one damage. Every damage definitely matters in this matchup. Okay, he goes ahead and draws two and discards a card again. Discarding a Mushroom Watchdogs, which definitely a little bit worrisome. It means he probably has better cards in hand. So he decides to go for the attack, and I decide to block, or I decide not to block, rather. Maneldor is essentially a 4-mana 3/3 with Vigilance at this point in the game, and I just feel like I can take three at this point. Not too big of a deal. Plays a Brandy Buck, which ordinarily I'd be a little bit worried about because it can make food tokens, but given, again, that Maneldor is essentially a 3/3 Vigi, I can just block it, and I'm okay with that. So I go ahead and I draw Birthday Escape, very, very good draw, because we can go ahead and turn the soldier token into the Ring Bearer, and not choosing Maneldor, fairly obvious reasons, because when Maneldor hits, it will exile itself and return to the battlefield, and that would get rid of the whole Ring Bearer status. Here, I consider perhaps playing Dreadful as a Storm, but instead I decide to hold up Isolation. I think that might have been another one of the situations where I'm just supposed to try to push some damage with the Dreadful as a Storm, in this case only 4 extra damage, by putting it on the unblocked Ring Bearer. So I am not quite sure about that play. Maybe that was better. I decided to hold up the Isolation anyway. Plus, this is the third turn with Bathsong, so getting a ton of mana, playing a bunch of cards supposedly, maybe play something that I'd much rather Isolation. So he adds the 2 mana, and I believe the first thing he plays is a Woe's Pathfinder. He's definitely thinking about this one for a little bit here. Yes, he does eventually play the Woe's Pathfinder. Still has a blue flowing, so essentially 5 mana total in order to cast something. But he ends up deciding to just go ahead and move to combat. Again, attacking for 3, I decide to not block. And I believe he does nothing else. So in the end step, in order to not waste my mana, I do decide to Isolation something. I decide to Isolation the Woe's Pathfinder because I figured the Eren Rider would give a little bit more value if it were to come back. Woe's Pathfinder kind of chokes on my mana a bit, and then he draws a mana dork, which is not like the greatest thing you want to see. Again, we see the dreadful, or sorry, more lands being drawn, very unfortunate. So now I decide to do the Dreadful as a Storm trick in order to push four extra points of damage. Decide to keep the Ring Bearer, of course, on the 1-1, and slam in for 7 damage, or sorry, 8 damage. So fairly considerate, considering he, or fairly, that's fairly notable, considering he is at 10 life. He does flash in a Gandalf end of turn, which is unfortunate. Also, he plays a Shire for turn, which is not great because he can make food tokens on turns where he doesn't attack. And here he decides to try to Ents Fury. So I'm obviously going to try to improvise the club something. So I think about this for a while. One train of thought is I could attempt to fizzle the spell completely by sacrificing the 1-1 and trying to kill Gandalf. The problem is that gets pretty blown out pretty easily with a pump spell or reprieve or something like that. So instead, what I end up deciding to do is just sacrifice the Maneldor and deal 4 to the face, because I feel like at this point, given that I had the Gandalf Sanction in hand, I need to try to essentially cheese out a victory with Gandalf Sanction. And unfortunately, that does not completely fizzle the spell because all targets are not nullified. So Gandalf does still get a plus one, or he still gets plus one until end of turn. That means he is representing 8 damage on board. And again, I'm at 11. And unfortunately, this attack also does cause him to create a treasure token because of the Brandy Buck, which is not great. Okay, so he does again decide to, or he does decide to gain 3 life of the food now, probably. So, you know, playing around instant speed shenanigans. So I draw a Pelagir Survivor for turn. So one train of thought is I play Pelagir Survivor and I play Gandalf Sanction. I kill maybe the rider, and then I block and block, and I go with an attack, and I'm hoping to basically draw anything. And of course, in my deck's fashion, we draw another land. Perhaps 17 lands was enough. I don't know if maybe that's just like a variance thing, if it was correct or not correct. Well, in any case, we do end up at this point, in order to stay alive and also deal 4 damage, not nothing, we do decide to try to kill the Aaron Rider, but you guessed it, reprieve again. And at this point, the game is over. I only have 4 lands. Gandalf Sanction kills something, and I take 4 on the crackback. I play Pelagir Survivor. I can't play Gandalf Sanction. I block one. It doesn't matter. It's the same outcome. So I play to my outs. I recast the Gandalf Sanction. I kill the 3-2, maybe on the hopes he plays around a Deceive the Messenger or something like that. But at this point, there's really no reason for Nathan not to attack. So at this point, I know the writing's on the wall, but I pray and hope he doesn't attack. But unfortunately, he does hit the attack all button, and I unfortunately lose the game and lose the match. Very sad ending to what was honestly a super great tournament. Had a ton of fun. I played, pretty well for the most part. I think overall, for this draft, we definitely made a couple minor mistakes, both in the draft build and gameplay portions. But overall, was really happy with the end result. My best record yet. Finally, top 8 in one of these things. Super intense competition. And while I did not qualify for the regional championship, I hope to do so at some point, and will hopefully make my way to Atlanta. But in any case, thank you guys all for watching so much. Hopefully you learned something. Maybe there's a line that you saw that I didn't catch or anything like that. Just let me know your thoughts in the comments and whatnot. Like and subscribe, I guess. Do YouTube things. And yeah, have a great day. Thanks for watching.